So now we reach to the last topic of this single degree of freedom chapter, and that is the response of single degree of freedom systems to general dynamic loading, a loading which doesn't follow any pattern. And this is, you may think that it is the most complex case when the loading is general. Maybe actually it is not the most complex case, because we will be using the same concept of superposition, but we will be using that step impulse case which we have just covered, and we can superimpose the responses of different impulses, and we assume that the general dynamic loading is composed of a series of impulses, right? So we will study actually two types or two methods actually for the response against general dynamic loading. One is called Duhamel's integral. In mathematics, it is also sometimes referred to as the convolution integral. This is classical method. This is closed form expression. Although that is a separate discussion, that once you get the response equation u of t from this method, that equation itself may require some numerical treatment in order to completely get that u of t, right? But at least we can derive the overall shape of u of t classically using this Duhamel's integral method, right? The second method is numerical method, the same one which I mentioned while replying to that question, that it is an approximate method and it is based on the step-by-step direct integration. So therefore I use the word methods. There are several methods available of this category, but I will be just demonstrating one of them, but that will be enough to give you an idea what others actually are, right? So this is an approximate method and this is classical method. Duhamel integral is valid only for linear systems because it is based on the principle of superposition. But this step-by-step integration method can handle both linear and non-linear systems. Your structure need not to follow Fs is equal to Ku. Even then, step-by-step integration will be applicable, right? So both of these methods can solve this equation, mu dot dot plus cu dot plus ku is equal to p of t. And now P of t is general dynamic loading, any order, any irregular loading. Now P of t can be anything, right? But Duhamel integral will be only applicable to linear systems governed by this equation. But step-by-step integration methods, they can be applicable to non-linear systems also. So this term will be replaced by any Fs which is not equal to Ku. Even then, the step-by-step direct integration method, they are applicable. So Duhamel integral is based on principle of superposition, and the idea is that any general dynamic loading can be decomposed into a series of short impulses, right? So if you have, for example, let me draw some general loading like this. So I can decompose it into a series of rectangular impulses like this, right? And the response against each rectangular impulse, we have derived that already. So if we sum all those responses, we get the total response against general dynamic loading, right? So this is the idea which is applicable only to linear systems. So therefore, Duhamel integral is only applicable to linear systems. The step-by-step direct integration methods, all of them, they are based on the direct numerical integration of the governing equation of motion in incremental form. They are based on the concept that this equation can be directly solved step-by-step manner. For each time instant, we can solve this equation, which will serve as the response will serve as the input for the next time instant. And from this idea, we get the word step by step. So the idea is that this equation can be directly solved for each time instant, one by one, and ultimately you repeat that in a loop until you get the response for all the time instants. Right? So we will see that we will invoke some assumptions in this method which will allow us to solve this equation of motion incrementally, and those assumptions will be the sources of error in this method. But there are no sources of error in the classical methods. They are beautiful, elegant methods. They give you the exact solution. So let me start the first method for today, and then we can continue in the next class. We were discussing the response of single degree of freedom systems to general dynamic loading, and we actually discussed in start that the response to general dynamic loading, we will actually be discussing two methods. One is called Duhamel's integral or convolution integral. This is a classical method and it is only applicable to linear single degree of freedom systems. The second method is one of many methods, in fact, and all of them are called step-by-step direct integration methods. So one of those methods we will be studying. All of these methods, they are numerical methods, they are approximate methods, and they are applicable to non-linear single degree of freedom systems also. So in this first session, in fact, we will be discussing the Duhamel's integral, this classical solution for single degree of freedom systems subjected to general dynamic loading. A general dynamic loading means that now the loading is fluctuating without any pattern. It can go in positive side, negative side, it can have any shape, right? So most of the real environmental excitations which our civil engineering structures are subjected to, they are actually general dynamic loadings. Earthquake, although earthquake is not a loading, but if you convert into an effective earthquake forces, those forces are random, they are general dynamic loading. Similarly, wind forces, they are general dynamic loading. They cannot be characterized or described by harmonic or periodic or impulse loading, right? So actually we are discussing here the most complex case, but it may not be most complex as far as the mathematical solution is concerned, but the nature of applied loading is the most complex. It is now general variation, or you can say without any pattern, random applied loading. So the first method, which is Duhamel's integral, the concept itself is very elegant, but the solution, when you actually apply that concept to a real case, you will see that you have to use maybe numerical integration or some other approximate method to solve for this Duhamel integral also. But actually the concept is very, very elegant and beautiful. The concept is that we have already calculated the response of our single degree of freedom system for a rectangular impulse. If the loading is like a rectangular impulse, we already have calculated the response. The closed form classical solution is already available for rectangular impulse. In last lecture, we have seen that it is actually the decay function times a constant times a sine function. So actually the response against a rectangular impulse is a sinusoidal vibration which is decaying its amplitude with each cycle because of that decay function, and it has an amplitude of this thing. So the height of that rectangular impulse P of tau is actually affecting the amplitude of vibration, right? Similarly, the time for which that rectangular impulse is applied, mass of the system and natural frequency of that system. So these four quantities are actually defining the amplitude. What I did here is that instead of writing the equation for any general rectangular impulse which is starting at t equal to 0, I just write it for an impulse which is starting at time t equal to tau. So the equation is now, wherever there was t in that equation, is replaced by t minus tau, right? So now our impulse is actually not applied at t equal to 0, it is applied at some specific time, and the response actually starts from that specific time. Before that, response was 0, and then at t equal to tau, our response of that structure starts, which is described by this equation, and we already know that equation now, right? So the concept is that why not divide or decompose our general dynamic loading into a series of rectangular impulses, right? So let's say that our P of t is now represented by this random line. It can be anything, it can go to negative side, then positive side. But the idea is that if it can be decomposed or it can be described as a series of short impulses, each is lasting for a fraction of a second, for example, right? And for each impulse, we already know the response classically. So all we can do is that sum all of those responses of individual impulses, and we get the response against that general dynamic loading, right? So we are actually invoking the principle of superposition, which is valid only for linear systems, and therefore this method is valid only for linear systems, right? So this is the underlying idea of Duhamel's integral, that any general dynamic loading can be seen as a series of short impulses, and each impulse will produce its own impulse response. Obviously, when we assume that impulse is having a duration which is described by this d tau, if d tau is very small, that small shaded area can be idealized as a rectangular impulse, right? Ideally, for any finite d tau, the actual shape of that shaded area may not be rectangle, but we can assume that as d tau approach 0, the shape actually is approaching a rectangle. So the sum of these rectangular impulses is equal to the response to that general dynamic loading, right? So let's now use this idea and see how u of t will look like mathematically. So let's say that du of t at some duration tau is the response of the linear single degree of freedom system at time t due to an impulse p of tau d tau. So let's assume that in that general dynamic loading, we take one slice of loading, and the height of that slice is p of tau. That slice is located at t equal to tau, so the height will be p of tau, and it is applied for a duration d tau, so that thickness of that slice is d tau. So if the response against that slice is du, then we can write that response as p of tau d tau times this quantity, which can actually represent the unit impulse response, or response to a unit impulse at t equal to tau. Let me go back and slightly rearrange this equation. If I just take out that p of tau in start, right? So I can write it as p of tau into d tau. This whole numerator can be taken outside, and whatever left, I can call that as the unit impulse response, because it is whatever left is being multiplied by the impulse itself, and it becomes the response to that impulse. So I can say this whole quantity, whichever is in that bracket, I can call it as a unit impulse response. That if I replace the impulse with a unit quantity, if this whole thing becomes one, then this whatever is in that bracket is actually the response to that unit impulse. So I call that as h, which will be the function of t minus tau, right? So the same rearrangement I have written here, that du of t at a time equal to tau, actually I can call it as the response against a unit response against an impulse which is starting at t equal to tau. That response of that particular impulse can be rearranged as p of tau into d tau, and whatever is left in the bracket I just call it as unit impulse response, and that is function of t minus tau. So equation was one is same as this equation, unit in fact the same equation of the rectangular impulse, but rearranged in a slightly different manner. Now obviously if the impulse is located at a time distance of tau, the response obviously will be 0 up till t equal to tau, and then it will start, right? So that unit impulse response also will be starting at time t greater than tau, and for time t equal to or less than tau it will be simply 0, right? So this du is actually the response of one narrow slice. Now all we have to do is to integrate that du, and we will get the summation of all the slices, or all the sum of all the individual narrow slices, or all the individual impulses, right? So just try to understand this this expression again. Du is what? Du is the individual response, that if there is one impulse which has a height equal to p of tau, and this is located at distance tau, du is the individual response for this one impulse, right? So it is rearranged. We know this equation, but now it is rearranged such that this p of tau d tau times this h quantity, and h we know already, h is this thing, it is actually the product of decay function and sine function, and divided by m over d. So I simply rearrange this equation, that m over d remain there, it simply goes under this decay function, p of tau into d tau is actually taken out, right? So this whole thing without p of tau, d of tau is the unit impulse response. If the height is equal to 1, if it is applied for a duration equal to 1, then the response will be h of t minus tau. Actually, the product of height and duration is called impulse, right? So actually their product should be 1, so we will say that this is a unit impulse. So if the height is more, the duration should be very small, so that their product is 1, right? So the impulse quantity actually, which is the product of these two things, that should be 1. So h of t minus tau is the response response of unit impulse, right? It's not the response for a rectangular impulse having height equal to 1 only. The whole impulse should be 1. The product of this should be 1 actually, in order to call this remaining thing as unit impulse. So if I say, for example, tau equal to 0, if tau is equal to 0, which means that our rectangular impulse is starting at t equal to 0. This becomes exactly the case which we have seen in the last lecture. So when tau is equal to 0 times delta t, and let's say delta t is the duration for which that impulse is applied, delta t. So at tau equal to 0 times delta t, which means this case, it will simply become p of 0 times delta t, which means p of 0. P of 0 will become simply this height of that impulse at t equal to 0. D into delta t, because tau will be replaced by this one, h t minus 0 times delta t, right? So this will simply become h of t. So if for example I talk about an impulse which is starting at tau equal to delta t or tau equal to 1 times delta t, I am talking about this second slice. This was the first slice, this is the second slice, right? The difference will be that the response will start at t equal to delta t. Equation will be same. So the response for this first case is starting at t equal to 0. The response for the second case is starting from t equal to delta t. So for time t equal to delta t, the response remains 0 and then it starts after that. Same, we can simply keep on adding the third impulse. Third impulse will be actually 2 times of delta t away from t equal to 0. So this will be actually 2 delta t. So first 2 impulses and then this is the third impulse. Then we can have 3 delta t, which will be fourth impulse. So actually we can decompose our any general dynamic loading as a sum of these series of impulses. And finally, simply what we can do is we can integrate the response of one impulse, this equation. We can integrate and we get the total u of t, and that total u of t will be integration from tau equal to 0 to any time t up till which we want to calculate response, p of tau, d tau, same thing, and h of t minus tau will be basically in that integration, right? So I simply integrate the response of unit impulse and I get the response against any general dynamic loading. Now this is called Duhamel's integral, this equation itself. So it simply says that you, if you have the function describing your general dynamic loading, and if you have h of t minus tau, h of t minus tau is known, right? Because if I go back, what is h of t minus tau? It is this quantity, and everything is known in it, xi, omega, omega d, m, sine function, right? So this h of unit impulse response is known already. All you need to do is that if you have a function describing your general dynamic loading, you multiply it with unit impulse response and integrate it for whatever time up to which you want to calculate response, right? So the equation is classically very, very elegant. Theoretically, you can solve it for any kind of general dynamic loading. But the condition is that you should have this p of tau. Your general dynamic loading should be described by a function p of tau. The issue is now that most of the real random loadings, they are not defined classically using any polynomial or any other thing. They are numerically defined. So if you have a for example, earthquake loading p effective or a wind loading, it will not be a very continuous function which you can simply describe by a mathematical function. It will be numerically defined. If for example we have the ground acceleration recorded in case of earthquakes and then we multiply it with mass to convert into p effective, for example minus m ug dot dot. Now this ug dot dot is defined numerically. It is recorded numerically. It is like t column and ug dot dot column, and it is like t equal to 0, the acceleration was 0, t equal to 0.01, it was some value, 0.02, it was some value, and it will keep on increasing up till like 100 seconds. So you may have thousands of data points which are actually describing your random ug dot dot. When you multiply it with a constant m, you get a random p effective, which now you have to apply to your structure, right? So the real random dynamic loading is numerically defined. It is not available in the form of a continuous polynomial. So therefore, the solution of this Duhamel's integral may not be very easy for real kind of dynamic loadings, right? So if you have p of tau defined numerically, you may have to use numerical integration, maybe trapezoidal rule or Simpson rule or any other numerical integration scheme to work out that integral actually, right? So this equation 3 is called Duhamel's integral, and it is it is actually the total response against any dynamic loading, which is described as a sum of many impulses, a series of impulse actually. In mathematics, it is also sometimes referred to as the convolution integral. But in structural dynamics, it is called Duhamel's integral. So if we have any 0-0 initial conditions, we can ignore the UH, because actually this Duhamel's integral is describing the forced vibration response. It is describing the particular solution. If you have any non-zero initial conditions, which means the structure was already in motion when the random loading started, in that case you have to add the free vibration case, or actually the UH you have to add to it in order to complete that the solution, right? But for 0-0 initial conditions, UH will be 0 and you only will have equation 3. For any other case, so I just add now the free vibration case UH, and it is added now to the forced vibration case. But generally we have 0-0 initial conditions, so Duhamel integral is enough for the solution of general dynamic loadings. So we will continue with the 0-0 initial conditions from now onward. So we will not be adding UH to this U of T. We will assume that this is the complete solution, right? So now let's put this at T minus tau here, and we can expand, try to find some more easy form of that integral actually. So h of t minus tau is this whole quantity, up till here. So actually if you see this h of t minus tau itself is a product of two functions. One is the exponential function, other is the sinusoidal function. So if you have p of tau, even if it is described by a polynomial, let's say I say p of tau is, let's say, some 3x square plus 2, right? And I say that from x may be 0 to some 10 second, let's say, right? Actually it should be p 3 of x square, and then I can define it for a particular x and for a particular time, let's say. Even for very simple kinds of p of tau, solving this integral, which will now be composed of actually three functions, will be very difficult, right? And as I have said, that for numerically defined p of tau, it will not be possible to actually evaluate this integral classically. So you cannot solve it classically using the theory of calculus and get some closed form solution. Maybe for simple kind of loading it may be possible. I mean, I would love to try, for example, if I say p of tau is sinusoidal, let's say. So we already have the solution for sinusoidal loading, but we can try it using this Duhamel integral also. Put sine function here and then try to solve that integral, you should get same equation. Mathematically you should reach to the same solution which you have solved for harmonic loading case, or any other kind of loading which can be described by a function. So let's try to simplify, or try to find some way of solving it, some other forms of Duhamel's integral. One form can be that I split this e of this function, exponential function, can be split into this. Similarly, sine some alpha minus beta can be rearranged by this trigonometric identity. Sine alpha minus beta is actually sine alpha cos beta, and similarly minus cos alpha sine beta. And this also can be expanded or written as this product of these two quantities. So this whole thing is the same as the original Duhamel's integral. I just expanded it further. I can rearrange it because now the integral can go to both quantities, this quantity and this quantity, right? So integral can go to both, and it can be split into two integrals. So whatever was multiplied by this that thing, it is with both of these integrals. So it is here integration of this thing, and then sine is being multiplied, and minus the same thing, integration of this thing into cos. So you can see it is the rearrangement of same Duhamel's integral which is at the bottom. So I have 1 over m omega d multiplied with everything, but now we have p of tau times this e raised to power something multiplied with one of this product and second of this product. So that rearrangement gives us another form of that Duhamel's integral, and that is I can call this whole square bracket as a of t, because it is a function of time. A of t itself is a very complex function. It is a product of this constant quantity times an integration which itself has again three functions, p of tau, exponential and cos, multiplied by sine omega dt, this one, minus this whole square bracket can be written as b of t times cos omega dt. So this u of t is now written as a of t sine minus b of t cos. But a of t and b of t are not constants now, they are now very complex integral equations, right? So this is a of t, this is b of t. If we can work out a of t and b of t for each in time instant, for example at t equal to 0, if I can work out a of t and b of t, I can calculate, actually using this equation I can calculate u of 0. For example, if I can work out t equal to 0, a of t and b of t at t equal to 0.01, I can calculate u of 0.01 at that time. So for all time instants, if we work out a of t and b of t, we can use this equation to calculate u of t. So our question is now rearranged. It is now a matter of calculating a of t and b of t, right? Now let's first solve for the, or look at the undamped case. Undamped case will be a bit simple, because this quantity will vanish from that equation. It will become 1. This also will become 1. And we will be left with two functions in the integral. The product of two functions can be handled, I think. It may not be that complex. And then we can also use numerical integration, like I said, trapezoidal rule or Simpson rule or any other scheme for numerical integration, which gives you an approximate way to solve an integral, right? So undamped case will be a of t, b of t will be without exponential function, without decay function, right? So we need numerical integration. We cannot solve that integral classically, even for simple kinds of loadings. Maybe, as I said, for simple may be possible. For example, when p of tau is when actually the applied loading is sinusoidal, or for other case. But we will here be seeing some numerical integration schemes. The very simple or most commonly used numerical integration scheme is called simple summation. For example, if you have a function f of tau and you have to integrate it, actually you have to calculate the area under the curve of that function, right? So one numerical integration scheme, simple summation, simply says that you divide that function into rectangular slices and just calculate the area of each slice and sum them. So if you divide into all of those slices into equal widths, delta t, right? So delta t into f naught, where f naught is the height of first slice, f1 is the height of second slice. So each can be multiplied by delta t to calculate the area of that slice. So delta t will be common from all the areas, and you can take that out, and all you left in the bracket is the sum of all the heights of each slice, right? So if you have any function f of tau, forget any solution now, just think of any general function and you have to integrate that using numerical integration. One common way or a very approximate way would be to use simple summation, right? Slice that whole function into equal rectangular areas and calculate each area, sum them. Obviously, it will be very approximate method because it depends on the solution in the selection of that delta t. If the delta t is small, that approximation that each of that slice is actually rectangular will work. But if delta t is not that small, you will have the small areas which will be actually error, right? So all of those shaded areas are not accounted for in the total area under the curve. So they are errors. So this simple scheme says that f of I is actually the height of that function at any distance, at any general ith slice, and delta tau is actually total t divided by number of slices. So total t for which you want to calculate that area, this is that total t up to this point, divided by the number of slices. So if you have 5 slices, so you will have 5 rectangles. So you have to actually work out 5 values of that function, f1 up to f5, for example. So I hope that you understand that point, that the function is available and you want to work out the area under the curve of that function, which is actually the integration of that function, right? So for example, that can be any function, that can be a polynomial function or any logarithmic, sinusoidal, trigonometric function, right? So all you have to do is to calculate the value of that function at different times, at different t. Okay, that's the first thing which I cleared. This f of tau is not applied loading. It is some function which we want to integrate, right? Okay, if you talk about applied general dynamic loading, p of tau, that thing, that will be most of the time available to you numerically, right? If, for example, you are given with a real earthquake ug dot dot, that t and ug dot dot graph is available or table is available, which means it is available numerically, and you have to plot that. You can plot that actually. Actually, you can plot ug of t using those thousands of data points which will be available, right? So trapezoidal rule says that you can idealize each of the slices not as rectangle but as a trapezium, right? As a trapezoidal quadrilateral. So the you can apply the area of one trapezoid, and actually you sum all the areas of those trapezoids. So a trapezium can capture that variation in that function better than a rectangle. So trapezoidal rule have this equation, and that is obvious also, because if you just multiply this quantity with first quantity, you will get the area of first slice. Then 2 times of f1 times this thing is the area of second slice, right? So actually this whole thing, this equation, is the sum of all of those trapezoids. So this is trapezoidal rule. It is better than at least simple summation. But there are several other schemes also. For example, Simpson's rule, you can try that one. Or there are other variations or available numerical integration schemes. All of them have same target, that you have some function which you cannot integrate classically. You want to calculate its integration, so you approximate it with some assumption, and then numerically you calculate the total integral, right? So now let's say that your function is not one quantity, it is a product of two functions which you want to integrate, because this is our case. Our case is what? If, for example, I want to evaluate a of t, I have to solve for an integral which itself has two functions, as a product of two functions, right? So if I want to solve this integration numerically, I first have to multiply these two individual functions graphically to come up with a combined function and then apply that numerical integration scheme, right? So if I plot p of tau alone, it may be, for example, like this. If I plot cos omega tau alone, it may be like this, right? So actually I have to evaluate the integral of the product of these two functions. So I should multiply these two quantities to come up with a third function, which may be anything, and then apply that numerical integration scheme, whatever, simple summation or trapezoidal rule or whatever, right? So point by point, I have to multiply these two quantities. At time t equal to 0, whatever is p of tau, this quantity, and whatever is cos omega tau, I have to multiply these two things to come up with this first number. Then for the second number, I have to multiply this next quantity with next number. So imagine that your p of tau is numerically defined. It is available for time t equal to 0, 0.01, 0.02 up till 10 seconds. So your delta t is already fixed, right? Your delta t is 0.01 second, the interval between the data points. So you also have to work out this cos omega tau for all of that times. So for this time column, you have to work out p of tau, that will be obviously available to you, that will be a given quantity. But cos omega tau you have to work out that for that whole column, right? For tau equal to 0, 0.01, 0.02 up till any other quantity. Then multiply these two columns to get a third column and plot that. That function will be this function, the product of the two functions. Now apply that numerical integration to the product of these two functions, right? So everyone is okay with this? Yes, please. I am simply talking about having a product function, which is a product of p of tau and cos omega tau. So you will have one p of tau column for like 1000 data points. You have a cos omega tau column for 1000 delta tau values or time values. Then you will have a third column, which is the multiplication of first two columns, and then you will plot that third column, right? So you will have this product function which you can plot, and then on that product function you can apply that numerical integration scheme, right? So similarly for b of t also, you have to work out an integral which itself is a product of two functions. So you actually have to first calculate these two functions. Actually one will be available, one can be easily available because that is known already, and then you have to plot the product of these two functions. That resultant or product function actually should be numerically integrated now. So here in this example, let's say this was your p of tau. It is any function, and these are all its slices. So you have p0, p1, p2. So let's say that delta t, let's say, is 0.01. So you have value of p of tau at t equal to 0, at t equal to 0.01, at 0.02, 0.03, and so on, right? So you have this column already, p of tau, that is available 0, 0.01, and so on. And you have first tau column 0, 0.01, so on, and p of tau values are available. And let's say that you have to multiply cos omega tau with it, and you have to integrate the resultant function. So you will plot cos omega tau function also. Since our values are very small, so cos function will be like this. Obviously it is going to 0 now and then up, but I am just taking first 6 values, let's say, so up to p6, let's say. So these are all the values of cos omega tau at each time interval. So you get a second column, cos omega tau. Now you multiply them and call their product as y of tau, right? So you have a third column, y of tau, which is actually the product, point by point product of these two functions, numerical functions now, right? So you can plot this y function now, and let's say that you want to evaluate the integral of y, which is very close case as our case, because our a of t and b of t is like that, right? So y of tau is our function, and we want to calculate the integral of y of tau. Let's call it as an. So using different integration schemes, the equation for this an, which is actually the integral of y of tau d tau, is actually the an. For different numerical integration schemes, the equation will become this. Since we have what is a of t, let me write it, 1 over m omega integral of, let me just write it, 1 over m omega integral of p of tau cos omega tau d tau. So p of tau cos omega tau d tau. So we already know that we have called this thing as y in the last slide. So actually a of t will be, a n will be 1 over m omega multiplied by whatever is the numerical integration for this thing. 1 over m omega will be there at the start, right? For simple summation, we have already know that if we slice our final function into rectangles, so the area of each rectangle, we can sum them, and all these slices have the same thickness. So the width of each rectangle is same, which can be taken common. So delta tau is common, and then y naught, y1, y2, y3, up to any y, right? So a of an actually, the integral of whole thing numerically defined function, a can be calculated using this expression. And we know now that if we have for each time instant, if we have a and b, we can calculate u for that time instant. Right, Duhamel's integral is basically composed of a and b. If we go for trapezoidal scheme, the equation for a n will be slightly different. It will be this one. 1 over m omega will be still there, but whatever is other than that is actually the trapezoidal rule for y, and y is the product function of p of tau into cos omega tau, actually this thing which we have to integrate for a of t. Right? If we go for Simpson's rule, the equation will be slightly different again. But every time you actually have to know that y function itself, all of its values for all time instant, from y0 up to yn, where n is the total number of slices, you need to know m and omega, and you need to know delta t, delta tau actually. That is already defined when you are given with the numerically defined p of tau. If your p of tau is already given in this form, your delta tau is already fixed. In this case, it is 0.01, right? So using any of these schemes, you can calculate a and b for each time instant, and at the same time you calculate u for that time instant, right? So point by point you work out u of t. So this was the case for undamped single degree of freedom systems. For damped single degree of freedom systems, now you can guess that there will be one more function which should be multiplied to get that y, and that is exponential function. So just imagine that you have p of tau times cos omega tau times e raised to power minus xi omega t, whatever is that. Now you get the product of three functions numerically defined as y of tau, and then solve that numerical integral using any of these schemes. So we can write these same three equations in the recursive form also. Like currently I just say y from 0 up to n minus 1, but I can condense that same equation in a recursive form, right? And that can be like this: a n is equal to some a n minus 1, the previous term of a, plus this additional term, where n equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So you put n equal to 1, right, with a naught equal to 0. So you put n equal to 1, you will get 1 a n, 2, 3, 4, 5, up to so on, and you get the same equation. So that recursive form is actually the same condensed form of the series, right? Similarly, we have the recursive form for trapezoidal rule or recursive form for Simpson rule. So one thing is for sure, that you cannot solve using the Duhamel's integral manually by hand calculation. Maybe it may be possible for if you have just 10 slices or 20 slices for your applied loading. But if you have thousands of data points for a real earthquake, from t equal to 0 with an interval of 0.01 up to t equal to, let's say, 50 seconds. So you will have thousands of numerically defined values of p of tau. So you have to automate this. You cannot do it manually for all time instants. Maybe for 10-20 time instants you can solve, but not for more than that. So for damped systems, simple summation will again have this additional term. Trapezoidal rule, Simpson rule, all of these recursive forms will have an additional term now, e raised to power something. So similarly, you can repeat the process for b of t. I just showed you for a of t, where p of t was multiplied by cos omega t, and then we have to integrate. For b of t, we have actually 1 over m omega, integration 0 to t, p of tau, sin omega tau, d tau, if we talk about undamped case. So the same process can be repeated for b of t also. Cos function can be replaced by sin, right? And once we calculate a n and b n for one nth time instant, for example, for successive values of capital N, we can keep on putting them in this equation and get the successive values of u of t, actually u n, right? So for each time interval, we will be solving this equation to get the u of that time interval. So if we have thousands of data points, we have to apply this equation 1000 times. We have to work out, in fact, thousands of a of t and b of t for each time instant, and then convert them into u of that time instant, right? So it means that u of t will also be numerically defined. It will be a table. If p of t is given as a table between t and p of tau, then u of t will also be a table at the end. You will have numbers, thousands of numbers, which you can plot to get that delta, that u of t, right? So I just directly show you one example. You can work out in different books. I have taken this from Clough and Panzine, and the loading which is given in this example is like this. It is a triangular loading. It increases linearly, then decreases linearly for a very short interval of time, like total 0.05 seconds, 0.025 for increase, and then same time for decrease. Reach to a very peak value of 96.6 kips. So these are American units. Kips is the units for force. So you have to work out the solution of this loading for this kind of, for this single degree of freedom system, where mass is given, actually weight is given, you can convert it into mass, k is given, and let's say damping is also given. I don't know, maybe first solve for undamped case and then solve for some damping case, right? So the unit conversions are given. You can convert it into metric units if you are more comfortable with that. So actually it is, if you look at it, it may be an impulse loading. It may not be a random loading. But now Duhamel's integral can handle anything. As I said that now, if P of tau is numerically defined, if it is defined at equal intervals of time, then you can apply you can apply Duhamel's integral. Whether the loading is impulse or it is harmonic or it is periodic, any kind of loading can be handled using Duhamel's integral, because any loading, any dynamic loading is actually can be considered as a subset of general loading. It can be treated as a general loading. So if you have a solution equation for general loading, it is also applicable to all simple kinds of loadings. So let's treat this impulse loading as a general dynamic loading. So all we need to do is, we have to define what is T and what is P of T, actually tau and P of tau. So let's say that I divide this loading into maybe 10 slices or 20 slices, equal intervals. So all I need to have is the value of P of T at those slices, right? Height of P of T at for each slice. So I say that at T equal to 0, P of T is 0. At T equal to 0.01, there will be, you can write the equation, linear equation for this line, right? Y is equal to mx. So you can just put x equal to 0.01, you will get y. So you know what is P of T at T equal to 0.01. And we also know that at T equal to 0.025, the number will be actually 96.6, this number. And then if you increase time from that, it will keep on, it start reducing. And at time 0.05, which is that total time, it will become again 0. And for all the time instants after that, it will remain 0, right? So we know, we should calculate the response not up till 0.05, but far after that also, because we know for these kinds of impulse loadings, the actual response is after the phase 1, right? So actually, although the loading lasts only for 0.05 seconds, but we should calculate the response maybe up till 1 second or maybe 5 seconds, because structure will have its own free vibration after this impulse. So that time column and P of T column is available. When this graph is available, that two columns are available. So let's assume that loading is numerically defined and we have to solve this single degree of freedom system using Duhamel's integral. So this table actually slices our loading into 10 steps from 0 to 10. For each time instant, it calculates P of n. We know that at 0.025 it is 96, and then it's again reduces. Then all of the next columns are actually the quantities required to calculate U of T. For example, for first n equal to 0, you will have some U n. So this column, second last column, is the response. This is actually un column, and we know un is what, an times cos, bn times sin, or I think vice versa, whatever that equation we know. So we have to calculate an and bn, and all the previous columns are actually the solution steps for an and bn. So we are given with P of tau column, we calculate sin column, we calculate cos column, then we multiply them and calculate y columns. This is y column, and then we use some numerical integration scheme in all of these steps to calculate an and bn, then combine them in the final equation to get this last column, right? So this is not using simple summation, by the way. In the book it was done using any other numerical integration scheme, but you can use simple summation or trapezoidal rule or Simpson rule, right? So this is including damping, so that e raised to power column is now added. e raised to power function is added in the product of numerical integration. So this is the final response. They calculated it up to this point. The actual blast, actually what they did is that whatever u of t they calculated, they again multiplied with k constant quantity to convert it into a hypothetical static force. So why they converted? Because they wanted to compare it with the applied loading, because applied loading is also a force. So now they have one force axis on y axis. So this triangle is actually representing the actual impulse load, which is actually a blast load, and this solid black line is the undamped response u of t. So you can see that in phase 1 the response is only like this up till this point. The actual response or peak response is in phase 2 when that blast loading was already over. So you can keep on just solve all and keep on having all those calculations. Even when p of t becomes 0, you will still be getting some non-zero u of t for next intervals, right? So at 10th interval your p of t was already 0, and then it remains 0 for all the next intervals. But still, if you look at the second last column, this one, this is the response column, you are still getting response, right? If you plot them, you get the curve like this. For damped case, 5% damping case, you will get this dotted line. Obviously the damping will reduce the amplitude, right? So if you keep on having more and more calculation steps, you will see that response will decay for undamped case, for damped case, and it will not decay for undamped case, right? So actually you need an automation for this Doha-Mills integral. For a simple kind of maybe 10-20 steps, you may do it manually, but maybe you need an Excel worksheet or MATLAB code for this, right? So the concept of convolution integral, we will be used again when we study the response of structure to random loadings from statistical point of view. We will be having one chapter about response to random vibrations, and in that we will again be using this concept of numerical integration. That will be actually the frequency domain response. Currently whatever we are studying is the time domain response. Our primary variable is time. We are plotting our response against time every time, right? But there is a whole version of structural dynamics which is called the frequency domain version or frequency domain response, where actually the applied loading is seen as a composition of some applied input frequencies, and the resulting response is also seen as a sum of different frequencies, right? So that will be discussed in that chapter. Again I repeat that it is only applicable to linear systems. Now one of the very common applications of this Doha-Mills integral, if you are able to actually apply that, is in the case of seismic analysis, where the governing equation of motion is this one. When you are given with any ug of t, you can convert it into p effective. And if ug dot dot looks like very random, for example for this particular El Centro earthquake in 1940, this solid black line is actually the fluctuation in ug dot dot, ground acceleration, the actual recorded acceleration which is defined numerically. So you can download that data. For each time instant you can download u of g dot dot. So it will be composed of thousands of data points which you can plot to get this curve or this graph. So when you multiply it with minus m, the resulting force p effective is also random, right? So one of the applications of Doha-Mills integral is that now you should be able to calculate the response of any single degree of freedom system against any given earthquake, right? If you can automate that in Excel sheet or MATLAB code or any other script, you can actually work out the response, actually the seismic response. U of t you should be able to work out now, right? P effective obviously will be simply minus m times u g dot dot, but for that given P effective you should be able to work out u of t now. So please try that. If you can do that, it will be easy for you to catch up with the next concepts, right? One more application of this Duhamel's integral can be that, for example, if you have one particular single degree of freedom system having a particular time period, and that time period is obviously it is a function of m and k, right? So if m and k are given, you can calculate t, right? So, and similarly, if c is given, you can calculate xi. So for one set of m, k and c, actually one particular set is representing one single degree of freedom system having one particular time period, right? So let's say that m and k are such that they are resulting in a time period of 0.5 second, and c is such that it is resulting in a xi of 0.02. You can apply one particular earthquake to this single degree of freedom system. You can apply that and you can calculate u of t. So this is u of t for that particular earthquake. Now you should be able to do it. Let's say that you repeat that exercise for different single degree of freedom systems. One with a time period of 1 second, one with a time period of 2 seconds, maybe 3 seconds, maybe 2.5 seconds, 1.5 seconds. So which means every set of m, k and c, you can carry out that dynamic analysis already if you can repeatedly do it. And if you can work out, if you can pick the peak quantity of response, let's say if I talk about the displacement response, u of t, every time what you can do is that you can pick one peak quantity, let's say maximum u, whatever is, for example, the total earthquake is 50 seconds. So whatever is the maximum quantity in that 50 second of u of t, every time you, if you pick that u max, ultimately you can construct a new curve in which you can have u max on y axis and time period on x axis. And obviously you should do it for all fixed damping ratios. Every time, if damping ratio is constant and if m and k are changing such that the time period is changing, if you can finally perform that analysis repeatedly and every time pick the peak response and plot that peak response on y axis, so this is u max on y axis and time period on x axis, because each time period is representing a different single degree of freedom system, right? So for example, if you do it 3 times for t equal to 0.5 second, 1 second and 2 second, actually you are working out the 3 points on that curve corresponding to t equal to 0.5 second. This point is actually the u max for this case, 2.48 second. So actually this number is 2.48 inches. For 1 second time period, you have the u max of 6.61. So 1 second, this point is actually 6.61. This is 6.61. And for third single degree of freedom system, 2 seconds time period, you have u max of 8.84. So this number is actually 8.84. You can keep on repeating this exercise and fill all the intermediate points and finally construct this new curve. This curve is telling you the peak response against the time period of single degree of freedom system, right? Now each m and k is giving you a unique time period, right? So this curve actually is giving you the peak response directly for any single degree of freedom system if its time period is available directly, right? So it's like you have carried out hundreds of dynamic analysis for one ground motion. So this should be for one ground motion, and this should be for one fixed quantity of xi every time. So for one ground motion, you can construct a new curve which is giving you the peak response as a function of time period of the single degree of freedom system. This curve is called response spectrum of that ground motion for that particular damping ratio, let's say in this case 2%. So if our earthquake was that El Centro earthquake, so I can say that this is my displacement response spectrum for El Centro earthquake for a damping ratio of 2%. Right? So this curve is very important. It has many applications. The very first application is what? That for any new single degree of freedom system, you don't need to perform dynamic analysis again to get the peak response. If you are only interested in getting peak response, you can simply calculate its time period and go to that curve and directly pick the number, because someone have already carried out that dynamic analysis for you to construct that curve, right? So it's a very convenient concept to directly get the peak response for that particular earthquake. So I repeat again that this curve response spectrum will be for a particular earthquake, and it will be for a particular damping ratio. If I repeat the same earthquake for damping ratio of 0.05, I may get a different curve, which will be what? Above or below this curve? Below this curve, yes. Obviously, the increase in damping will reduce U max for each case, and then you get a curve which will be slightly below this. Now look at the responses of individual single degree of freedom systems. For a time period of 0.5 second, which means this is a single degree of freedom system which itself wants to complete one cycle in 0.5 second if it is allowed to vibrate freely. That desire of that single degree of freedom system is evident in its response also. Although it is a forced vibration response subjected to a ground motion case, still it is having a very high frequency corresponding to somewhere t equal to 0.5 second. Look at t equal to 2 seconds response. Obviously, one observation is that the peak displacement has increased, but another observation is that now the response is low frequency because its time period is high, 2 seconds. So this system itself wants to complete one cycle in 2 seconds if it is allowed to vibrate freely. So the system's desire is evident in the forced vibration also. And therefore, I told you earlier also that this omega or time period and natural frequency concepts, they will be used in forced vibration response also. They are being used. You have seen that in the forced vibration equations, omega is required. Omega is a primary contributor to those equations, right? So graphically that is evident in this figure also, right? Physically, you can think of t equal to 0.5 second as a system which is very stiff, like a low rise building, very stiff, because you have to have a very high k to get a very high omega and very low time period. So a stiffer structure actually for the same ground shaking is vibrating in a very high frequency wave like this, and a flexible structure, 2 second structure, is a flexible structure because time period is very high, it is very flexible, taking 2 seconds to complete one cycle, is its own response is also depicting the same trend, low frequency, right? So it is having low number of cycles in the given time. One observation is that as the time period is increasing, the peak amplitude, peak displacement, U max is also increasing. So the displacement response spectrum overall have an increasing trend. And since the actual shaking, actual earthquake, actual UG dot dot is random, so therefore you will have this U max curve also will be random, right? They also, it will be very shaky, although the overall trend will be that the U max will be increasing. But sometimes it decreases also, then again keeps on increasing. So it will be very shaky line because it is a real earthquake. One more observation which you can have from this curve is that, for example, the U max is achieved not at one particular time instant for all the cases, right? So here U max is at this time, here it is at this time, a different time instant, and here it is at this time. Sometime it is on one side, left hand side, when the single degree is on left hand side. Sometimes the U max is when the single degree is on the right hand side. So sometimes U max is positive side, sometimes it is in the negative side. Here also negative side. So, but when I say U max, I mean the absolute value, because this plus and minus is simply showing the directions from the mean undeformed shape. What else? This curve is called response spectrum because it is giving you the whole spectrum of all the possible responses which your all possible single degree of freedom systems can have, right? So you have performed all the hundreds of dynamic analysis in a loop to get that curve, right? So it is giving you the spectrum of responses for one particular earthquake. So it is telling you that one earthquake is not dangerous, or it doesn't have the same damage potential for all the structures. It will produce different peak displacements in different structures. Same earthquake, same damping ratio, different peak displacement for different structures, depending upon their own time periods, depending upon their own combinations of M and K, right? So if you have a one-story building here, one-story building, and here you have a 10-story building, let's say. Here you have one story. So the same earthquake is producing low displacement in one story and high displacement in 10-story. So this curve is the whole spectrum. So think of whole city lying on the x-axis. You have a dam, it will be somewhere on this axis. You have a bridge somewhere on that x-axis, because that bridge will have some time period, some m and some k, which will result in that time period. That dam or that building will have some time period. So all you need to work out is its time period, and if you are given with that spectrum curve already, you can simply tell the peak response. Most of the times we are interested only in the peak response. We are not interested in the complete 50-60 seconds of history. So the peak response for that particular earthquake is directly available, if the curve is available, or if you can construct that curve using Duhamel's integral, or in fact putting Duhamel's integral in loop for all possible time periods, right? Yes, please.